Good evening, and thank you for coming, and thank you very much for having me. I'm not used to speak to microphones. We don't have that at York University. We normally shout. I wonder, can you hear me all? No? So I better shout. My talk comes with lots of preambles. I only turn to the topic of primitive accumulation and capitalist accumulation. I think it's getting better now. It's working. I only come to the topic in the middle. Because in a way, what is important, I think, is not primitive accumulation, nor capitalist accumulation. What I think is important is to understand the premise, the social premise of either primitive accumulation and capitalist accumulation. What, in other words, is being accumulated? And what is accumulation and accumulation of? My little bit, which comes later, of course, on primitive accumulation can be summarized by this one sentence from Marx, which I got from the critique of the Goethe program, and I quote, "The whole class, the existence of a whole class of individuals," he says, "who possess no other property than their labor power, and who must therefore," he says, "become the slave of other individuals who have made themselves the owners of the means of existence." I slightly amended that, because Marx always speaks about the means of production, not about the means of existence. But ultimately, the means of production are the means of existence. The means of production are the means of subsistence. Means of production means nothing else but our, as us in terms of society, our metabolism, our exchange with nature. That's what the means of production are. Our exchange with nature. The means by which we exchange with nature in order to live, in order to subsist, in order to achieve social reproduction. And Marx says that the one who has nothing left but his or her labor power becomes, by necessity, the slave of another person who has made himself the owner of the means of existence. I'll come back to that topic later, but just as a footnote, what really does it mean to have nothing to subsist on? To have no means of subsistence? What concept of freedom does that entail? What concept of struggle does that entail? What concept of despair does it entail? If a whole class of people tied to work have nothing to subsist on, then the hopeful sale of their labor power, or maybe their kidney, or maybe other organs that can be removed in order to gain what needs to be gained, namely access to the means of subsistence in order to live, in order to exist. That's the end of my first preamble. Now, my second preamble. It starts with a sentence that I have started papers with over the last 20 to 25 years. And the sentence is this: read it at a time that resounds with misery. This idea that I could give this one sentence time and time again over the course of 25 years puts our own misery in perspective, puts our own complaint in perspective, puts our own moral condemnation of what exists in perspective. It does more than putting things into perspective, however. All too often, capitalism is criticized for getting things wrong, for creating this misery or that misery. And it seems that what is wrong with capitalism is not capitalism as a condition of human social reproduction, but the very situation one finds oneself in. Lots of critique of capitalism is based on the situation one finds itself in. The situation is wrong. And from that follows, if only the situation could be improved, bettered, rendered humane, if only this politician were in charge rather than that politician, if only I were in charge, because one always thinks that one's an abstract negativity of capitalism, has at the same time the resolution to what needs to be done in order to improve, in order to better. However, the circumstance that I could give this one sentence, really for the time that rebounds with misery, for 25 years, and that the judgment is true, justified, and rightful, and sincere, and honest, means that maybe the critique of capitalism has not to be a critique of the particular situation we find ourselves in, but rather that it has to be a critique of a condition. The capitalist condition. Is poverty, is misery of scraping a life at the bottom of the barrel, is that the outcome of wrong policies, of IMF interventions, of the wrong parties winning elections? Is it really just dependent upon contingent outcomes? If it were, then poverty is not a capitalist problem at all. All one needs to do is get the right parties in, regulate the IMF, and then we would have a capitalism without poverty. What a fantastic capitalism that would be. Or is poverty rather part of the conceptuality of capitalist wealth? Does the wealth in profit presuppose, and is it not premised on, the poverty of the worker? If it is poverty, a capitalist condition, what do we mean by eradicating it? Eliminating it? What's the seriousness of our critique? Is our critique of capitalism a mere lament, morally outraged until you get the right sort of job? Is it a mere abstract negativity that sniffs around capitalism to find defects that one might want to solve? Or is the critique of capitalism something entirely different? Namely, an attempt to understand its conceptuality of wealth, its conceptuality of social being, its conceptuality of what it means to be a laborer. no critique can go without moral condemnation, but what happens if we just stay there and don't think further into what we condemn? That's the end of, as it were, the second preamble. It comes with a footnote. It is time to stop thinking about capitalism. It is time to think out of capitalism, to think within the conceptuality of its being, of its concept, of its social relations, of its notion of wealth, from within, not above, in order to understand what it holds, in order to understand what it can be, in order to understand that the law of value presupposes at its premise the rule, the force of value. The presupposition of the law of value is the force of value, and the force of value is nothing to go on lightly with. It kills. It terrorizes. There is no law of value without the force of value. My third, I think, preamble is this. To think within capitalism, or better, to think from within its constituted reality, is subversive. Subversive thought is none other than the cunning of reason. When confronted with a social reality in which the poor and miserable are asked to pay the bill for financial rescue. Money is being redistributed from workers to capital in order to sustain, to stabilize, to rescue the illusion of fictitious wealth. Thinking from within the conceptuality of capitalist wealth, from capitalist society, this subsidy by the poor is absolutely necessary to prevent the system from imploding. Just imagine, here is our condemned capitalism, and it doesn't take from the poor. It doesn't try to intensify labor, pay less in wages, doesn't extend working hours, doesn't see the worker as a producer of surplus value. What a capitalism would that be? Thinking about capitalism, one can come to these conclusions. It should not do that. It should not do this. Yet, thinking from within, it's absolutely clear the poor are there because they are the premise of the concept of wealth. The dispossessed laborer is not an accident of capitalism, but the premise of its existence. So this rational irrationality, where the poor are asked to subsidize by their own poverty and their own labor and their own misery, an irrational system of wealth that is fictitious to the extreme, like a Ponzi scheme, this rational irrationality is in fact what Marx's critique of political economy focuses on. The critique of political economy asks, why does this content, human social existence, human social reproduction, why does this content take this form of an irrational, seemingly self-moving, seemingly self-moving positive economic logic that imposes itself over the acting subjects, as if by force of nature. And of course, it does not really impose itself over humanity. It imposes itself in and through the acting subjects. Economic laws don't prevail over us, they prevail also in and through us. Nobody escapes the marketplace. Everybody has labor power to sell in order to live. There is then a need for praxis. This is my fourth or fifth preamble. There is then a need to fight balance. What sort of praxis is it? Barbarism cannot be fought in a direct and immediate way. How do you combat interest rates? How do you fight the movement of coins? How do you fight poverty in a system of wealth that is premised on poverty? A praxis that fights barbarism is about the social preconditions that make themselves manifest, that assert themselves as a relationship between things, that assert themselves as the movement of economic quantities, that asserts itself in terms of interest rates movements, price movements, labor market tightness, redundant labor. And these preconditions, of course, relate to the very creation, the absolute precondition of capitalism. And that is the existence of the laborer as a seller of labor power. Each united in the understanding of what it means to be a laborer, each, I say provocatively, disunited, ready to price him or herself into work for the sake of making a living. What really does it mean to be a laborer? To price yourself into work in order that you and your family exist. Doing that with the knowledge of a shared, a common class experience. Against that background, and that's my sixth preamble now, reification, the idea of reified things, a reified world, really is an epiphenomenon, something that is important, but not decisive. It's an epiphenomenon. Critically conceived, reification is a critical concept. It is the concept of the false society. Critically conceived, it asks about the social constitution of our world. Why does our metabolism with nature, our subsistence, take this form of a relationship and of a movement between economic quantities upon which we depend, as if by fate? So reification, either is this critical concept that asks what is reification a reification of, and what is in reification, or verification is not a critical concept. And if it is not, then it becomes affirmative of existing society. Then the constant charge that things are reified is in fact spellbound by the very society against which officially at least it protests. The tireless charge of reification is tiresome. It affirms, it deifies the very things it is meant to dissolve. And in this manner, the constant charge that things are so bloody reified suggests that the movement of coins upon which we all depend is in fact its own constituted reality. Not the reality of social relations in an inverted form of economic laws, but exists by and of and in itself. So the flow, the movement of capitalist freedom in the form of coins needs thus to be redirected, needs to be improved, needs to be bettered, needs to be made more socialist. What's wrong from this perspective with capitalism? It's not capital. What's wrong from this perspective with capitalism is the capitalist or the imperial power or the IMF. These capitalists that use capital for their own interests, for their own freedom. What misery. This way of thinking about capitalism, like Proudhon did, leaves capitalist society, its conceptuality, its constitutions, its way of being entirely untouched by thought. In this manner, the protest against reification becomes itself reified, divorced from thinking, and it becomes irrational. What is reification? A reification of? What appears in reification? If the world around us really is a world which is governed by economic laws, irresistible force that impose themselves upon us as if by force of nature, then that needs deciphering. That needs understanding. We need to get behind the secrets of our world in order to comprehend it. The secret, I guess, or I argue, of an equivalent exchange where two different things are rendered equal to each other is the concept of surplus value. Money is more money on the condition that money represents more value. The secret of making money out of money, the secret of an equivalence between money and more money, that secret cannot be found in the relationship between use values and exchange values. That secret can only be found in the concept of surplus value. That is to say, the equivalent exchange relationships are founded on the class relationship between the owner of the means of existence and the seller of labor power. And the seller of labor power is fundamentally a producer of surplus value. To be a productive laborer is not an ontologically privileged position. It is a great misfortune. The critique of class society is not a critique for fairer class society. The critique of class society finds its positive only in the classless society. This brings me to my next preamble. Money, trade, exchange, markets are not unique to capitalism. Coins, trade, commerce, markets all existed long before capitalism existed. The question, therefore, is not the question of the market. The question of the market is, what is marketed? What is sold? What is bought? And for what purpose? Second, money existed long before capitalism as a means of payment, as a means of circulation, as a means of wealth, hoarding, as a means of connecting the sale and the buying of things. None of these functions of money make money capitalist. What makes money capitalist is money as capital. And money as capital is the money that begets more money, that posits itself, that is thrown into circulation on the understanding, on the expectation that it lays golden eggs, that it comes out of circulation, back into your pocket, expanded, augmented, bigger than before. That is what makes, or what is significant about money in capitalism. Not that it mediates market exchanges. Not that it operates as a means of payment, or a means of circulation, or a means of hoarding, even. What makes money in capitalism specific is that it is thrown into circulation on the understanding, on the expectation that upon withdrawing it again from circulation, it has expanded, it has valorized, it is now unequal to itself. So money as capitalism has the obscure quality of positing, it seems, its own expansion, its own increase. What are the preconditions for that? What needs to exist for money to be able to do that? What needs to be bought on the labor market in order for money to be able to expand? And Marx's answer, you know, is quite clear about that. What needs to be available is the free laborer, the doubly free laborer, who sells what only he or she has left in order to gain access to the means of production, and that is his or her labor power, and he sells it as a worker of surplus labor time, as a laborer, as a producer of surplus value. So when we speak neoliberalism about markets, about marketization, about commodification, we need to be specific. What makes markets specific as a capitalist market is that the proprietor of labor power really is the owner of nothing else but labor power, and has to sell it. What is specific about capitalism, therefore, is not the market, but the labor market. and its creation has been written into the annals of human history with blood, with fire, with terror that was used so that the laborer internalizes that very discipline that is required so that the buyer of labor power might purchase his labor power on the expectation that he or she does not go home after 4 hours' work, but stays on until money has laid golden eggs, has expanded. I now come towards the idea or the topic of primitive accumulation. I've been writing about primitive accumulation since the late 1980s. After a couple of years, I do it again. It's like rewriting this one article time and time again, and each time it somehow becomes something else. My first publication, as it were, primitive accumulation, had to do with the following observation. What does it mean to say that primitive accumulation is the transition towards capitalism? What does that mean? Was capitalism already innately existing within primitive accumulation, waiting to be freed, to be born, to become? Was capitalist accumulation the necessity, objective necessity, unfolding necessity of that process? What does transition mean? Transition is the idea of something is logically unfolding towards something. Has history, as it were, already been written? Is it just unfolding in front of our eyes? Do we just enact something which is already there? What do we mean when we say that primitive accumulation is a transition to capitalism? Looking backwards, it makes sense. But when it happened, was it really a movement innately connected towards the achievement of capitalism? Adorno writes that the history of the world is the history, he says, from the invention of the slingshot to the atom bomb. Does the slingshot, this thing, does that has as its innate further development the atom bomb? Is the atom bomb contained in the slingshot? Adorno's argument makes sense only on the basis that the atom bomb helps us to understand the slingshot, helps us to understand a history which has been made, forced, as a history of violence and destruction. At each turn of its development, something else might have been possible. Some alternative was suppressed, some alternative was killed, some alternative was eliminated. The sentence that history is the history of the invention of the slingshot to the atom bomb only makes sense on the basis of the atom bomb, not on the basis of the slingshot. Similarly, Marx. He writes that history has been the history of class. What is meant by it? Is history programmed as a history of class struggle? Inescapable? Irresistible? Or does it make sense to say history has been the history of class struggle because our society as a society of class struggle makes it possible for us to understand the misery, the conquest, the spilling of blood that has gone before it. Or as Marx put it in the Boniface, the anatomy of man, he says, can explain the anatomy of the ape. But the anatomy of the ape does not explain the anatomy of man. The anatomy of the ape did not contain man as its destiny. History makes sense by looking into it in order to understand the present, our relations. And that is where my research now is, on primitive accumulation. We critique the conception, the conceptuality of primitive accumulation makes no sense as a history of transition which was inevitable, objective, preordained, logically unfolding, leading to us. Primitive accumulation as a concept makes only sense because it is the premise of capitalist wealth. It's the foundation of the capitalist social relations. Primitive accumulation makes sense because our social relations are historically stamped, historically branded, historically made. There cannot be a conceptuality, a concept, an existence of capitalism without the buying of labor power by those who are the producers. Oh, sorry. The buying of labor power and the selling of labor power by sellers who are fundamentally the producers of surplus value. Primitive accumulation is a very strange concept. Even in German, ursprüngliche Akkumulation. Because in Marx, accumulation means the expansion of wealth. Primitive accumulation didn't expand wealth. Primitive accumulation was not the production of a social surplus. Primitive accumulation was robbery, expropriation, forcing people off the land. It was, in modern language, almost like a redistribution of wealth. I get it all and you got nothing. It doesn't mean we have more social rights. No, we don't. It simply means you ain't got anything and I've got it all. And yet, Marx uses the word primitive, not primitive, ursprünglich, accumulation. And he makes clear, capitalist accumulation is not based on piracy. It is based on surplus value extraction. And surplus value is extracted for one purpose only, its reconversion into productive engagement. So that money lays golden eggs time and time and time and time again, and if it does not, then we enter a period of crisis. So why does he persist in using the word primitive accumulation? Why does he persist in using accumulation, expansion, growth, to describe something which was merely robbery? Maybe because he read Adam Smith, and Smith, of course, talks about original accumulation. But maybe there is some other reason as well. And the other reason I put forth is, in order for capital to accumulate, it has to reproduce. It has to perpetuate. It has to reposit its very foundation, its very condition of existence. and that is the freedom of the wage laborer. A freedom not from his or her stereo, bedroom or mattresses or television. No, the freedom from the means of making a living. The freedom from the means to subsist. The freedom from the means of existence. That is the fundamental precondition of capitalist accumulation. In that context, it makes sense to speak of primitive accumulation as the beginning, as a start, as the basis, as the origin upon which capitalist accumulation depends time and time again. The idea of primitive accumulation is now very much on vogue. It has been very much popularized by David Harvey in his book, The New Imperialism. He argues, as far as I understood it, that capitalism continuously returns to notions of primitive accumulation, particularly to the period of crisis. And he argues that primitive accumulation is not now something only that is outward going, trying to find new workers that can be dispossessed, but that dispossession now happens again in terms of the primitive accumulation as at capitalism's center, imperialist center. This notion of primitive accumulation has its origin in Rosa Luxemburg's writing. She argued that in order for capitalist accumulations to stabilize, in order for crisis to be overcome, capitalism depends, she argues, on something outside of itself. It has to find new markets, new raw materials, access to new workers. And thereby primitive accumulation was seen as the starting point of capitalism, but also to result, as it were, from its crisis-ridden development. During the 1970s, this understanding or interpretation was very much highlighted by Shamir Amin. He argued that the mechanism of primitive accumulation does not belong only to the prehistory of capitalism, he says, but they are contemporary as well. It is these forms, he argues, of primitive accumulation modified but persistent to the advantage of the center that forms the domain of the theory of capitalism and accumulation on a world scale. Here, in this discussion, we have a very strange relationship between prehistory, or the prehistory of capitalism becomes its imperial effect, becomes its imperial result. How can this be understood? That something which is deemed prehistoric becomes nevertheless the necessary movement of its expansion, of its attempt to avoid crisis, as a means of overcoming crisis, as a result of its own process. And I argue that this can only be understood because primitive accumulation is the constitutive premise of capitalist accumulation. And I'm now just three or so pages, which are basically quotations from Marx where this is highlighted. It forms primitive accumulation, he says, in Capital Volume 3, or no, Capital Volume 1. It forms the concept of capital, or for those German speakers, es bildet den Begriff des Kapitals. So primitive accumulation constitutes the conceptuality of capital. He says it's the foundation of capitalist production. and it's given in capitalist production. It is, he says, the historical basis of the capitalist mode of labor. All methods for raising the productivity of labor are developed on that basis. Capitalist accumulation, he argues, maintains primitive accumulation on an expanding scale. He says, I quote, "The condition of its becoming passed thus over into the results of its presence." Capitalist production of itself, he says, reproduces the separation between labor power and the means of production as the premise of the concept of capital. So the presupposition then of Marx's understanding of the conceptuality of capital as more capital, as value in process, as money in process, and as such, capital, the presupposition is the owner, that there is an owner of the means of subsistence. And that there is, on the other hand, an owner of labor power. And that this exchange between the owner of labor power and the buyer of labor power is one, he says, of the Eden of human rights, governed by equality, freedom, Benson, each seeking to us make their own interests count. He argues the buyer of labor power has the right to consume it. If you buy an apple, you bite it. Can you buy labor power? Can you bite labor power? The capitalist, by buying labor power, has bought it. It is his. The trouble, though, for the capitalist is that you can't consume labor power. You have to consume the worker. But the worker has not sold him or herself. This is the fiction of the law, Marx argues. And the laborer, therefore, has the right to contain the use of his or her labor power in order to live, in order not to be scrapped, in order not to die prematurely, in order to live another day. He or she says, "You, capitalist, did not buy me. You bought my hands. You bought my ingenuity. You bought my ability to work, but I did not sell myself into slavery." And the capitalist insists on his rights. Of course he does. Why shouldn't he? He has bought your capacity to work. And now he bought it in order for its usage to provide a profit, to make value expand, to make the hands, the capacity, transform into activity, an activity of surplus value production. Conceived as eine ursprüngliche Akkumulation, primitive accumulation is not primitive at all. It constitutes the capitalist form of labor in the form, I quote, of objectless, free workers. It is the divorce of labor from the means of existence, from the means of subsistence, from the means of life that turn workers into proletarians and transform the means of subsistence, the means of production, into capital. Labor, divorced from the means of production, is the foundation of capitalist reproduction. Therefore, primitive accumulation is not some period of transition that already had, as it were, capitalism as its destiny. The importance about primitive accumulation is that it constitutes the specific capitalist form of labor. Human purposeful activity in the form of a laboring commodity. Here, labor really is free, because the laborer who has been freed from the means of production has not to obey anybody. He responds or she responds to economic compulsion, economic necessity, but he or she is not the property of somebody else. It's not a slave. So capitalist accumulation thus is based on this fundamental form and condition of freedom. The freedom of the seller of labor power is the freedom not of personal dependency, it's the freedom of economic bondage. So, I quote, "The freedom of the wage laborer amounts on the one hand to the same old dodge of every conqueror who buys commodities from the conquered with the money he has robbed them of. On the other, I add, the freedom of contracts between equal legal subjects of law who trade labor power, one seeking to consume it for its investment, lays golden eggs, makes money, provides profit, and the other desperate to sell it in order to dodge the freedom to starve." I quote from Marx, "The Roman slave was held by fetters. The wage laborer is bound to his owner by invisible threads." And here's the difficulty. In order to maintain access to the means of subsistence, to food, to clothing, to housing, to education, the laborer really has to be exploited well, because the continued sale of labor power depends on progressive accumulation. It depends on the successful extraction of surplus value. The rate of accumulation regulates or determines the rate of unemployment. And therewith, the conditions of the buying and selling of labor power. Marx's notion of the slave is much better expressed by Adam Smith in The Wealth of Nations. I quote, "The freeman is responsible for his own subsistence, whereas the slave is in the keep of his master. The slave, says Adam Smith, is thus of more expense than the worker, and the work of a freeman comes cheaper than that performed by a slave." The capitalist is not responsible for the worker's well-being. It's the worker's own responsibility. And despair drives people to price themselves into jobs, to sell their kidneys, to hire out their wants. So I quote one more time from Marx on primitive accumulation. "Primitive accumulation," he says, "originally appeared as a condition of its becoming. Now," he says, "it appears as a result of its own realization, reality, as posited by it, not as conditions of its arising, but as results of its presence. The absolute fundamental condition, Marx writes, of capitalist accumulation is the reproduction of the capitalist relations between the owner of the means of production and the seller of labor power. I have two more pages to summarize and then now my conclusion. We heard earlier about the commons, the commune, the common. The term common is a term of abuse. Who wants to be common? The word commoner is a term that is used to describe those who live in ranks, the bottom of the pile. For itself, the bourgeoisie never calls itself the commoner except a fancy dress party. For itself, the bourgeoisie calls itself the cosmopolitan. The different commons. It's the commons of Madame Leterre and Monsieur Le Capitaine, who do their ghost walking along the globe in search for profitable engagement of their money. What then is, as it were, the common good of a capitalist society? The common good of a capitalist society is the good of profit that is being accumulated. The essence of capitalism is capitalist accumulation. That is its common good. It does not point beyond itself to something else. The commoner is also often also associated with the nation, the tribe, national equality. It is normally only the workers who are asked to behave with patriotism, with national pride, to adhere wholeheartedly to this regressive notion of tribal equality. For the capitalists, clearly, if a capital cannot make the return its employment would accord it over there, it will go. I say, quoting from David Ricardo. What is the communist common? In itself, what's the working class in itself struggling for? I guess it struggles for better wages, conditions, employment, defense itself against the werewolf hunger for surplus labor. It defends itself against ever more destructive conquests for additional atoms of labor time. It defends itself, its life, against the time of capital. And the time of capital means, or entails the existence of the worker as a time's purpose. As labor time, it entails the reduction of lifetime to labor time. It struggles for respect, education, recognition, human significance, above all, for food, shelter, clothing, warmth, affection, knowledge. In that sense, the struggle in itself really is the struggle for itself, for subsistence, for existence, for lifetime, for the satisfaction of basic human needs. And then, suddenly, I quote, society finds itself put back into a state of momentary barbarism. It is as if famine, a universal war of devastation, had cut off the supply of every means of subsistence. Industry and commerce seem to be destroyed. And why? Because there is too much civilization, too much means of subsistence, too much industry, too much commerce, Marx says, in the Communist Manifesto. Too much industry, too much commerce, too much civilization, too much means of subsistence. How can that be in a society where people are hungry? How can there be too many means of subsistence? Is there not enough demand? People satisfied? Big belly sitting in front of their telly having eaten too much? Too much of it. What Marx here means by too much is not use values. It does not relate to an idea of people having no longer any need to consume. It's too much of what? It's too much in order to make a return. It's too much for money to beget more money. It's too much for money to make itself expand. There's too many means of production because subsistence, because no profit can be gained from selling this stuff. It's too much of it. And how, he says, does bourgeois society get over these crises of too much? On the one hand, by enforced destruction of the mass of productive forces. On the other, by the conquests of new markets and by the more thorough exploitation of the old ones. Now, austerity. Let's ask the question of austerity completely differently. Let's ask the question of austerity not in terms of austerity, but ask the question in terms of labor time. How much labor time was needed, say, 2012, to produce the same or more commodities as in 1992? I don't know, 50%? 30%? 20%? And yet, work, this werewolf hunger for surplus labor time, has not decreased. It has increased. So despite this increase in labor time, despite this increase in wealth, we are living in a time of austerity, as if famine, a universal war of destruction, suddenly cut off the means of subsistence. What a calamity. Less living labor is required to produce the same amount of commodities than only yesterday, and society finds itself cut off from the means of subsistence, forced to accept frugality, forced to be more industrious in order to perpetuate a mode of production in which human productive effort asserts itself as a crisis of finance, as a crisis of money, as a crisis of cash flow. The current crisis, it is argued, requires the appropriation of additional atoms of unpaid labor time. to resolve the crisis of debt, the crisis of money, the crisis of the cash flow. There really is, it is argued, a need for a real breakthrough in labor productivity. It's right. Time in capitalism really is money. There is no time to waste. Time is money. Time is wealth. Free time is not wealth in capitalist society. It's the time of surplus labor. It's the time for the production of surplus value. That is the time of wealth. It is performed by a class tied to work because this class has nothing else to live on but the sale of his or her labor power. History does not provide us with any promises. History does nothing. History does not fight, does not unfold. History does not possess great wealth. History is made. The making of history means to accept violence, uncertainty, hardship, bloodshed. And it means to accept it without knowledge of its outcome. To make history means to embrace uncertainty. And uncertainty is not a condition of life. Nevertheless, historically, this notion of uncertainty, this acceptance of uncertainty, this hatred of that what is certain and what is certain is misery itself. This hatred also gave itself certain organizational forms of organization and defense, from the commune to the council, to the Räte, to the sovereigns, to the assemblies, this democracy of the street, which is the laboratory of communist freedom. Its validity is its own uncertainty. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the excellent lecture. I think there's enough for thought. And now I'm opening the discussion. The floor is yours, comrades. If you want to pose a question, if you want to comment, just raise your hand and you'll get the mic. I guess I'll use the opportunity. I really liked your critique of the commons, and I was just wondering if you've dealt in your work with the organizational forms. You've mentioned some in the end, the commune, the Soviet, the assembly, and I was just wondering if you could elaborate on that. Where do you see the perspective for the political strategy in the struggle nowadays?
Before elaborating, I don't want to provide a critique of the commons. But the commons only makes sense on the basis of its social content, on the basis of its purposes, on the basis of its aims and objectives. The council, the commune, the Rate of the Soviets were commons too, as is a fascist commons. The term itself does not, as it were, project progress, progressive ideas. The content is more important than the form. If we discuss the commons as a form, separate from its content, from its purposes, then we emptying ourselves out. We make ourselves relative. We accept friends who are not friends. The enemy of my enemy is not my friend, or not necessarily so. So the idea of the rete is the idea of a way in which people in struggle organized their purposes in common with their own aims and projects and purposes in deadly fight often with a system of rules that if the system succeeds, even the dead will not be safe from the revenge. And that is the condition of the idea of the commons, the system of defense for purposes which cannot be integrated into the existing system, into the existing social relations. The commons in that sense as a council is a purpose which develops an entirely different conception of wealth, of society, not one based on cash and product, the seizure of the state, the use of power, but one of the common organization of existence, where wealth is the notion or is based on the idea of free time rather than on money as time.
Thank you very much. So please, questions and comments.
Yes. I wanted to, this may not be obvious from your talk now, but reading your work, the early work, and knowing about your general positions, you're very critical of leftist attempts of any sort to use the state or state mechanisms as a even practical device, as an instrument of emancipation or whatnot. But since you have so vividly and so expressively described precisely what it means to be a laborer, in the sense of to be what it means to be a proletarian condition in the sense of being fully coerced to sell one's capacity to work over and over again. So this structural blackmail, which basically forces you to embrace capitalist discipline, capitalist logic, to price oneself into activities which are basically done, if you look at the low labor process, which are made not only as a slave in that sense for that period, but so it's an object of someone else's will, but also a machine like, if you look at many of the occupations. I mean, if you look at the products of labor process, what it means to raise productivity, what it means for the laborer, what kind of use of one's capacity to work is demanding, which is debilitating and often utterly frustrating. So if you know, we know that, and at the same time we know that there have been historical struggles of one sort or another against this in history, and that some of these struggles have resulted in a very relative lowering of this immediate blackmail to sell this immediate dependency of on the wage as the sole source of one's existence and reproduction. And many state institutions, social institutions, to a certain extent, if you look at a historical scale, to have healthcare provided without having to exchange money for it immediately, to have the right to education, to have guaranteed housing, to have a minimum, well, to have sources of food supply, irrespective of the success of the sale of one's labor power. These are certainly, I would say, not only achievements in themselves, they of course do not count for much from the perspective of what the left, the historical left, has envisioned as the end goal. But they are also, I would argue, they are mechanisms to weaken the immediate, heteronomy of capital over one's life, at least to a degree. And this this provides that space of free time or the capacities then to look to develop other forms of power, the ones that may possess a deeper promise of perspective of transformation. So this is what I was always curious about. If someone it seems not only the dismissal of the state functions, but fundamentally the dismissal of their the space that they make in technical space. Of course, without guarantees, but if there are no other, I'm saying that these are instruments that shouldn't be just pushed aside as inherent flawed they are, but in lack of other. Of other mechanisms, it seems to be almost the alternative seems to be, and this is also a tendency in the left, to substitute it with a kind of almost theological evocation of a new of be it the event or of spontaneous forms of alternatives. But capitalism, what it does is systematically eradicate the space for alternatives. So. And those well, I don't want to go on too long, but those pockets of relative autonomy from the immediate demand of the labor market, I mean, they must possess at some level a technical value.
I think one of the best definitions of the state been provided by Adam Smith. Really conceived of political economy as the science of the statesman and legislator. So political economy is office. Political economy is therefore not a theory of economy. Economy by itself is no independent existence. Economy by itself, just thought of by itself, would be cutthroat, chaotic, fragmentary, would dissolve. For Smith, economy was political economy, and political economy is the science of the statesman and legislator. How to legislate, how to govern, how to make society accept the perfect liberty of the market as an ongoing concern of public policy. The critique of the form of the state is the same as the critique of capital. Labor, in order to live, depends on economic growth, depends on progressive accumulation. It is the rate of economic growth that regulates the rate of unemployment. Having understood that, I do not become a supporter of economic growth for the sake of economic growth. It merely means that within the conceptuality of capitalist wealth, the worker depends for his or her life on the productive extraction of her surplus labor for the sake of surplus value, that in the form of profit is exchanged between commodity and commodity with the labor market and is reinvested in earned profits, that is, in new productive engagement. Having understood that, does not mean to say that the critique of political economy is in fact a theory of economic growth. the critique of the state does not mean that the critique that the state does not provide the conditions for health, for education. It pays me. I'm glad to be employed by the state. My wage is handsome. However, being paid by the state does not relieve me of my obligation to tell the truth as I see it. My knowledge, my insight, my honesty, my sincerity has not been bought as a consequence. So the critique of the state is at the same time the critique of capital. On both the state and capital, the laborer depends for his or her life. Thirdly, the value of labor power is the social necessary labor time that goes in to reproduce the worker. But, says Marx, it provides for an historical and moral element. This moral and historical element does not fall out of the sky. It is not a natural product, nor does it come to us by divine inspiration. The moral and historical element is the determination of the value of labor power by means of class struggle. That's what it is. And this austerity regime really is a struggle over this moral and historical element. To get away from it, to destroy it, and to destruct it, welfare is a moral and historical element that has been brought to the state by force of struggle, and it is paid for by the laborer him or herself, by means of taxation, by means of indirect taxation. It is not really paid for by the capitalists. They hide their profits in the Cayman Islands of the world. The worker himself pays for his or her welfare state penny. So the critique, as it were, of capitalism does not come down to the notion that capital attempts this, that capital does that. I never said hello to capitalism. Shook its hand, kissed it, and missed it. And yet we speak about it as if it were an active subject. We talk about the state. The state does this. The state does this. Have you ever kissed the state? The state might kiss you. It's the button on your head. But you can't kiss the state. It's not a subjective reality. It's not a subject as such. Yet, and rightly so, we ascribe to it subjective powers. It does this. It attends that. And we ascribe and attribute subjective powers to us. To it, sorry. Because in reality, it really is a real abstraction. An abstraction that is real in the manner in which it organizes our world. When Marx says that human social relations become asserted or manifest themselves in the form of things, that he does not ascribe subjective power to things. And yet it is the things that rule over behind their backs, as if by force of nature. Well, it's important to understand this. What materializes, manifests itself behind our backs is in fact our own work, our own effort. We might not be aware of it, but we do. So the critique of capital is to say capital is not the same. Capital fundamentally is just a name. It is a name for a particularly organized society, for a particular conceptuality of wealth. It is a name of a capitalistically constituted relations of labor, for a capitalistically constituted metabolism with nature, in which the products of labor take on the form of Monsieur Capital, ghost walking. In that sense, capital or the state are really that ghost. Their ghost walking is real. as a real economic abstraction. We are governed by the movement of economic quantities. We are. The question is, what is this quantity a quantity of? How? What is it? How is it constituted? How can it be deciphered? To go a step back, in Marx's critique of religion, Marx does not say God doesn't exist. He does not engage in a scholastic dispute with other theologians how God might best be understood. Is he a woman? Black, white? Nice, orphan? How does he or she govern us? No, he says, in order to understand God, we have to decipher the social relations that create God as this thing that really governs over religious society. Think under belief. The same approach has to be taken with the idea that capital does things to us. Capital has never done anything to me. Capital society does. We can involve ourselves in a scholastic dispute. Is capital this or is it that? Is it this bit of finance or that bit of productive activity? But that really is a scholastic dispute as to how a system that we do not understand, how a system should distribute its wealth, how much for labor, how much for the owners of stock. I'm falling back on Adam Smith because this conception of classes comes from Adam Smith. But if capital really is not a thing, if it's a secularized logic, an economic logic, then we have to ask the same question that Marx asked in his idea or his critique of religion. What is the nature, the social nature, of the human social praxis that vanishes in its own creation, God or capital, only to reappear with a price tag, cow and bar, ever ready to make life worthwhile by pricing itself into work? The critique of capital is not what is good and bad, which one is better, scholastic disputes. The critique of capital is to say, what is its social constitution? And why is it that its social constitution vanishes in its constituted concept? A constituted concept which really is the economic category of quantity, of interest rates, of price movements, of interest rates up and down, of cash, dollar, of cash. Why is it that we produce our existence in this fantastic form, which appears to govern over us only because it prevails through us? The same is the question of the state. State, as I said, a fantastic organization as the political form of the society over which and through which it governs. It does not come from the sky, does not come from nature, it has no independent logic, as distinct from the logic of the economy. Political economy is not politics, and political economy is not economics. Political economy is the governing of our exchange with nature. For the sake of great wealth, on the condition of great impoverishment. That's what the theory of political economy is a theory about, a theory of a particularly organized mode of social reproduction, appearing in the form of service.
Yes, please.
Two very short questions, I hope. In light of your view on the political importance of the construction of a new socialist communist commons to the commune council, to what extent do you consider the least experiments as enacted in occupying the canal, etc., as potential opening moments in such a procedure? Question number one. Question number two is, in light of the historical experience of the communes, Paris Commune, the Shanghai Commune, etc., and its invaluable violent clashing, what organizational form today would you consider to be adequate to deal with the unspeakable violence that would be inflicted at the moment that such construction of a new commons becomes a serious threat to the continuation of the value form?
Should we take another question, I believe?
Yeah. Yes. The core of Marx is social relations. And one of the things that we don't talk about when we talk about primitive accumulation is the destruction of a form in which people have the potential to govern among themselves. So it's not just taking from the individual or taking from a group of individuals, but it's destroying the means of a particular kind of society.
Can I come to your point first? In my view, to be a laborer is a unifying class experience that asserts itself only by means of disunity. And therefore, solidarity is as much part of the labor movement as is disunity, as is the racialization of labor markets, as is the demand of British jobs for British workers, which is the undermining of the unity of experience. So class is a concept of unity and disunity, and both at the same time. And I think that makes, I'm not criticizing the point, I'm trying to make it, as it were, in my own words. To your question. I think the most important lesson, I guess, about the struggle for uncertainty, the struggle for overcoming and transcendence, is not to accept the division of the world into an economic sphere and into a political sphere. It is this division of the world which governs the world as it is constituted. The most important, for me at least, alternative to existing social relations is to take this logic of separation, and primitive accumulation is a logic of separation, back, to try to overcome that, be it the logic of separation between the economic and the state, between economic compulsion and the law of freedom, the liberal rule of law, the separation from us and our product, the separation within ourselves, each vying for position. It's this logic of separation that has to be overcome. But it has to be overcome not for the sake of employment, job prospects. That is very important because people live on it. But it has to be more if it wants to be true to its stated purpose. It has really to enunciate this different conception of human development, not one driven by the successful sale, one's own employability, one's own investment, capital, interest rates, power for its own sake. It has to be driven by the overcoming of the logic of separation. Part of this overcoming is, I believe, the politicization of social labor relations. Because what we're talking about in terms of primitive accumulation is the divorce of the laborer from the means of labor. Now, how can that be overcome? Only by means of politicization. By not recognizing that the political belongs to the state, has no place in society, has no place in the economy. As if the state really is a successful agent that concentrates the political character of bourgeois society. So the force of the commons the force of the alternative, its ability to politicize itself, to politicize labor relations, to politicize what it means to engage in a metabolism in order to exist, to politicize existence, to take away, as it were, from the state, its ability, its capacity to be the only recognized monopoly power, at least by liberals, namely the monopoly power of the political, or as Marx put it, the concentrated force of bourgeois society. That, I think, is what the commons, as a political force of transcendence, of human emancipation, has to be about, to recognize one's own world as one's own world, and act on it by means of politicizing social labor relations. However, I wish you not now to go out to do it and act on my behalf, because this is a very difficult thing to do. This is an existential thing to do. It is a thing of great misery, of great bloodshed, of great troubles. And if you die, you will not be safe, as I mentioned earlier, in your own grave. It will be destroyed in two ways. People will be desecrated and build a monument for you too in celebration of this modernizing impact that you have had in your struggle. Your own struggle will be turned against you, and a monument will be erected in the name of power, legitimizing existing the new power that you allegedly have given rise to. That is something that you really have to keep in mind.
I believe we have time for one more question, I guess. Yes, please.
That's not really a question. I just wanted to expand a little bit on what was said before about the left and the state, or what has been said today several times about the left, the state, and the welfare institutions. And I think as much as they are important, and that's not a question in any way, it's a means of protecting people from absolute poverty or helping them to spells of unemployment and so on. This is convenient from an individual point of view. So it's always convenient if you're thrown out of work to have some money, income, and so on. But still, even from the individual point of view, it's still degrading, because still, from a point of view of capitalist society as a whole, as a totality, there is a structural or objective limit on how far this welfare provision can go, because it depends on, basically, either you existentially depend on your own wage work, or if you're unemployed, poor, a student on a stipend, you depend on someone else's paid work. So you have this structural imbalance, and if there is no productive work, there is no accumulation. If there's no accumulation, there's no taxes. So basically, in a capital society, you have a ceiling on how far can you push this autonomy from wage relation. And this, I think, is also the limit. Although I find the leftist struggle for the expansion of welfare institutions very important, if not even crucial, in this as a short-term objective in the age of austerity. We still have to keep in mind that there is a structural limit to how far can you push it without overthrowing capitalism itself, without abolishing the law of self-expanded debt, etc.
Yeah. What should I say? Smith once said that the poor are regulated by death. And it's for that reason good to have a welfare state paid for by the workers in employment. It's good. In parts of the world, the poor still are regulated by death. In some parts of the world, the poor still sell their kidneys and other organs for prices. What does it mean to be employer? The term, as far as I can see, of employability means that nobody actually is ever unemployed. Nor does the term employability mean that anybody is employed either. Employability means to be a worker in constant transit from one form of employment to another form of employment. So if one is not a productive laborer, that doesn't mean that this person is not an employable laborer, who, as far as human capital theory has it, invests in himself or herself. To be a worker, not unemployed, but a worker in transit, self-responsible, not kept. The problem with the term left, as I see it, is all too often the left looks on the bright side of things, rather than looking at what it needs to see. It looks on the bright side and then it moves on, recommending year after year after year the same remedies, which only makes sense because it does not look at the problem. It does not know what question to ask. It looks on the bright side. It's good to look on the bright side. It's very understandable because the bright side is a side of sunshine and pleasure. To look at the issue, to act on the issue, then one cannot move on. Then it might become a dangerous place. Therefore, it's very understandable that the left looks on the bright side and moves on. By looking on the bright side, the left accepts certainty. Namely, the certainty that its critique of capitalism will have no consequences whatsoever. And that tomorrow will be just like today. Or that there is indeed a tomorrow. To get into things, not to look on the bright side, means that the certainty of tomorrow is in question. That what follows on might not follow on. That the sequence of a life, lived yesterday, lived today, and lived tomorrow, that sequence somehow stalls. In this sense, revolution is like sitting, the idea of Benjamin's. It's not to work for tomorrow. It's to work against the continuation of today. It's like pulling the emergency brake and say, stop. In that sense, I'll come back to what I said earlier. It's much better to say that history doesn't follow us. We just have to wait. See what happens. Look on the bright side. If you look at the thing, then the emergency brake is what you have to catch. But if you catch the emergency brake, you seek redemption. Not in a religious sense. What you seek is to survive, and to survive pulling the emergency brake is the sense of redemption, not to be buried with the other victims of history, not to become yet another monument for the history of rule. So I don't want you to look on the bright side. But not looking on it is difficult.
Well, thank you very much. Before you all leave, I would like to use the opportunity and to invite you to another exciting lecture taking place at the same place at the same time. Beginning at 6 p.m. tomorrow, David Cucnelli will give a talk on primitive accumulation, migrant workforce, and social reproduction in the age of austerity. You're all kindly invited. Thank you.